He sips tea with lemon while I drink coffee. That's the difference between us. Like me, he wears a white striped shirt. Like him, I read the evening paper. He doesn't see my secret glance. I don't see his secret glance. He is quiet and so am I. Yeah. somewhere invisible. A crow creeps aside blocks of autumn clouds with his toes and dives into the sky in my eyes, hung with the wind and the light. The sign of the crow. Sulfur brew of a nun of black night, croaking and piercing a hole in a flocking bird mattress to perch on a branch in my heart. Just as in the days of my youth, conquering crow's nests in the treetops of my hometown. My hands will never again touch that autumn landscape, hands scaling another tall tree, intending to pluck another crow from its darkness. Crow. Once it was a kind of bird meat, a pile of feathers and entrails, and now a desire for a narrative, the impulse to speech, and perhaps it is self-consolation in the face of adversity, escape from a mass of inauspicious black shadow. This is even more difficult since childhood days, when my hand reaches into the blackness of such nest. And this is even more difficult when a crow perches in the wilds of my heart. What I wish to give voice to is not its symbol, not its metaphor or its mythology. What I wish to give voice to is crow. Just as in years gone by, I never found dove in a crow's nest. Since childhood, my hands have been covered with a thick calluses of language. But as a poet, I've never given voice to a crow. With the circumspections and far-sightedness of age, proficiency in various inspirations, styles and rhymes, just as when one begins to write, dipping the brush deep into the oil and inkwell, I thought that the syllables had to be drenched in black from the very start to handle this crow. Skin, flesh and bones, the flows of the blood as well as the flight paths disclosed in the sky, all drenched in black. A crow begins in this blackness, in flight towards an outcome drenched in black. From the moment of birth, it enters into solitude and prejudice, into universal pursuit, persecution and of darkness and fires. But after all that, there's no escape beyond the bounds of crow being. Neither fly higher, approach on the territory, nor condescend to the lower realm of the ants. Cave maker of the sky, both his own black drill hole and black hole, on high and alone. From the heights of a crow, it sets a course according to its bearings, its time, its passages. It is one happy-go-lucky, big-mouthed crow. And outside it, the world is a mere fabrication, no more than the boundless inspiration of crow. New people, the fastness of the land in the sky, the fastness beyond the fastness. You people, the poet and ensuing generation. day, when I looked up into the blue sky, each crow was already drenched in darkness, a corpse eating crows. I should have turned a blind eye earlier. In the skies of my hometown, I stalked them once, so innocent then, a whiff of the stink of death, and I panic and loosen my grip. And as for the skies, I should have kept my eyes on the skylarks, white cranes. How I love and understand those beautiful angels. But one day, I saw a bird, an ugly bird, the color of crow, hanging from the gray ropes in the sky, with mangled legs, stiff and straight as the wings of a puppet, on crooked flight on the slopes of the sky, circling a center of some kind, out tracing an insubstantial enormous circle. And I heard a chorus of ominous crumbs, suspended somewhere out of sight. And I wanted to say something. I wanted to say something, something to declare to the world that I was not afraid of those invisible sounds. I was not afraid of those invisible sounds. I was not afraid. time will have to go by before our present becomes our past, just like us. We'll face our death, but first we'll defend the trees we wear. We'll venerate the bell of night, the moon hanging over our shacks. We'll defend our leaping deer, the clay of our jars, the feathers in the wings of our last songs. Soon you'll raise your world over ours, blazing a trail from our graveyard to a satellite. For this is the Iron Age, distilled from a lump of coal. Champagne bubble for the mighty. There are deaths and there are colonies. There are deaths and there are bulldozers. There are deaths and there are hospitals. There are deaths and there are radar screens to observe the dead, as they die more than once in this life. Screens to observe the dead who live on after death, as well as those who die, to lift the earth above all that have died. White Master, when are you taking your people and ours? Into what abyss is this robot bristling with aircraft carriers and jets, consigning the earth? To what fathomless pit will you descend? It's yours to decide. A new Rome, a technological Sparta, and an ideology for the insane. But we'd rather depart from an age our minds can't accept. Our homelands through stones, through the glimpses of skulls, through the speech of stars, through the air suspended above lakes, between softness of fringes and ears of corn.
Enough time to tell. Enough time to tell.
human being with a simple desire. I raise vipers and sparrows for the one I admire to figure out why on earth life is so costly. Why under my armpits my postman is reading the Bukowski. I snatch salamanders and stir them in my coffee. If you don't believe me, ask Laura Limonji. A woman who hides fibers and counters in the folds of her neck. She grows hair on her teeth in the discotheque. Miss Golden too was quite outspoken, even though we are all housebroken. Thank you very much.